here with Duke Stump from Northstar Manifesto, who spoke as part of the Sustainable Brands opening session. And Duke, you talked a lot to us about yesterday about your experience. You've been with Nike, and then you were with Seventh Generation, and now you are doing something called Northstar Manifesto. And we didn't get to hear a lot about that, but we have heard a lot from a lot of the speakers here at the conference about this whole idea of a Northstar goal or a Northstar. As an aspirational way of looking at things. Tell us what the Northstar Manifesto is all about and sort of what your view on that is.
Yeah, I guess the best to understand it, when I left Seventh Generation, I decided I should just take a year off. And I wanted to kind of sit and observe it, because I was fascinated with this industry from the perspective of there was an abundance of great ideas, but I also saw a lot of untapped potential that remained untapped.
Okay.
And I've always been a big believer in having a sense of a driver or a future North Star, if you will, that in many ways can kind of suggest the possibility of what could be. That really is my obsession, is how do you transport yourself from what is to this place of possibility and what could be. So the North Star Manifesto is my own brand and agency. And I am hesitant to always say the word brand, because it's not about brand idea or anything about like that. But it's really about helping great ideas position themselves and kind of unlock the potential, if you will, so that they really do it. They're bountiful and fruitful, and they can grow in the way that I think they want or intended to do. So
that's great. Now, talk to me a little bit about why do you think... Because it is, every speaker has said something about their North Star goal or their companies or their organizations. Why do you think that's striking? Why is that resonating right now with people? That whole the whole idea of something that's big and aspirational. And what is, I guess I can understand the allure of something that's big and aspirational because it sort of takes the pressure off of today. Mm-hmm. But how do you link what's big and aspirational, that North Star, mm-hmm. with something actionable that you can do today?
Yeah, well, if you think about the sustainability space as a whole, I mean, yes, it's been a conversation, you could argue, since Rachel Carson came out with Silent Spring. But it's just now really starting to get traction. And what's happening is there's a lot of moving parts, and people are, I think people are, there's a lot of activity,
right?
But the question you could say is there a lot of productivity.
Okay.
And so I think what's nice is if you can take a systems perspective and then create this North Star that's suggest, you know, I'm a big fan of what is the effect you want to create, and that's actually how I help companies create North Stars, is if things were working really well and you were in this space, and what is the effect you would create? And it can be a simple image. It can be anything. It doesn't have to be anything so concrete.
Okay.
In many ways, I always, at Nike, used to go to the auto show in Detroit. And it was, the fascination was how people were holding the future of concept cars.
Right.
And many times those cars wouldn't come into the line, but the thinking or something around it would excite or ignite a new level of thought.
Right.
And the other thing I think about a North Star, which is nice, is, okay, imagine this place of what you want to do and what you want to be. And then it's always a hard discussion. But then what's nice is if you ask people, okay, well, what are the keys to unlocking that? And it's kind of like the, truth serum,
okay.
In a way, where you have to say, okay, I want to be there. But to do that, I'm going to have to do all these things. And if you do it well, you do it in building blocks,
right?
So you don't say, okay, I'm going to do this one quantum leap to get there.
Right.
I like to work back and say, all right, if this is ultimately the effect you want to create,
mm-hmm.
we know what are the things that we need to reconcile to get there. Now, what are the building blocks or the constellation points that will get you to the North Star?
So that's how you make it actionable, is by looking at it and breaking it down.
And it makes it manageable.
And manageable.
Right. Absolutely.
Maybe not as exciting.
Yeah, I actually do think it's empowering, because there's nothing worse than having a North Star, a sense of possibility, and then not having a plan where you're actually achieving steps along those milestones, because then it actually can become...
It becomes less real to you.
Or disempowering. You know,
right.
You feel like, all right, well, yeah, it's frustrating, and angst comes in, whereas if you actually can have these manageable steps, you feel like you're progressing, you're proactive... Your culture as a whole has a whole new sense of vibrancy about it.
So I think this sort of moves right into, in your talk, you talked about your five principles. You said you have a lot of them, but kind of boiled it down to five. And what really occurred to me when I was listening to you is that, you know, a lot of your principles are really about people.
Mm-hmm.
It's about the human capital and about the need to be, to put humanity at the heart of every deliberation, I think you said, or mm-hmm. or that sort of thing. So it really, and then it's about traits of people too, about trust and authenticity, right. And I loved what you said about inspiration versus desperation and how you come from a completely different place. I think that's so true for everybody.
Right.
What do you think? That seems different to me. That seems to be a different way for companies to think about things. I mean, I think companies to an extent have always valued their workforce, but they think of them more in terms of a workforce,
right.
As opposed to thinking of them in human capital. So what do you think the shift is? Do you think that's part of the shift, is that companies are beginning to look at their people as being something that are actually a key to unlocking that potential?
I think it's for the progressive companies that are really looking at organizational structures or organizational development mm-hmm. in learning organizations,
right.
And really taking more of a systems point of view, in recognizing that from an efficiency point of view, from just a pure kind of successful point of view, the companies that actually appreciate capital, human capital, as
right.
the best capital,
right.
are really the ones that can thrive. I mean, I've always said, especially in this day and age, I would much rather have great people and no money than a marginal team and an abundant marketing budget.
Right.
Because it's the ingenuity of great capital, I think, is what we're seeing as making the biggest difference. And so I've always been a big fan of human potential. I think Nike was always about the possibility of the human spirit.
Right.
And so nurturing and cultivating that. But then also putting it in this place of inspiration. I mean, this movement, I find it incredibly ironic, right? Like, in this movement, it's all about doing well and doing good.
Mm-hmm.
But for so many people, it's paralyzing, it's frustrating, and it's angst-ridden.
Right.
And it's like, well, what can you do to create a shift where it goes from desperation to inspiration? And, you know, as I said last night, I mean, negative visioning is seldom sustainable over time.
Right.
I mean, it's like a coach who can really kind of say, you play not to lose. You might be successful sometimes, but ultimately, it's not really a successful formula.
It's not a good strategy.
And I think the other thing is, and it goes back to one of the first principle is, it begins inside, which is great brands have great cultures. So it's like, how do you even inspire your culture, right?
Right.
And when you're working from a place from inspiration, you're proactive, you're feeding off one another, there's a tremendous energy. And so to me, it's the key for many of these brands right now in this space is, how do you hold this conversation around sustainability in a way where it comes from a place of strength,
right.
And empowerment and inspiration?
As opposed to feeling threatened, desperate, or...
Yeah, like if we don't do it, then X will happen. That's
right.
Not a strategy. Or, hey, we're just going to do a green product and it really doesn't connect to anything else you're doing. That's not a strategy.
Right.
Especially for the long haul.
So if there is this change coming in, I think we especially here at this conference believe there is,
mm-hmm.
what do you have any observations about? What are some of the breakthrough models? How is business going to be defined differently in the future? I think you're touching on it a little bit by talking about an emphasis on human capital mm-hmm. and an emphasis on the positive versus the negative kind of strategizing. Have you observed anything that you really consider to be a breakthrough?
I think there's hints of it, and I go back to, I think it really comes back to systems thinking.
Okay.
You know, Buckminster Fuller talks mm-hmm. about looking at things through the widest possible context to see the whole. And imagine, for example, if we couldn't use the words green or sustainability, how would we hold this conversation? And I think that's a great thing to ask everybody.
That is a great question.
Like, if you couldn't use those words, what would you be doing?
Right.
And I think in doing that, it would, for many people, hopefully open their eyes and widen the lens a bit to say, okay, it obviously is about doing the right thing.
Mm-hmm.
But the biggest thing for me is that brands and companies and cultures need to come at this from a point of who they are in a place of strength so that it's from them, of them, by them.
Okay.
And when you do that, I mean, IBM is a great example. I mean, shifting from big green ideas at one point, which they, and I, you know, I'm not knocking them initially because I think we all wanted to do something green.
Sure.
But then recognizing, like, hey, that's not the most efficient thing for us. The
that's
most efficient thing is, who are we? We're a great company built on technical solutions. What about those we serve in the global need, focusing on efficiency and creating a whole model around a smarter planet? I think companies that do that and really try and mimic the approach for positioning, how IBM did it, I think a little bit of GE and eco-imagination. Obviously, companies that are from this space do it naturally.
Right.
Patagonia, New Belgium Brewery, Method, Seventh Generation. But it's the brands that are just getting going, where positioning it from a place of strength, I think, is so important going forward.
And one of the questions that I have when you talk about companies like Patagonia and New Belgium and those companies that we sort of refer to as having sustainability in their DNA versus the companies that are coming to this discussion now, it doesn't make their participation any less important, but it does really challenge that business model of, you know, the next quarter and the next earnings statement and the whole idea that, you know, they talked a little bit about it on the stage today about the B Corporation. Like, how do you have a conversation with your board of directors that maybe, you know, shareholder value is not going to be maximized if it's not synonymous with our responsibility to the environment and to society? And that to me seems to be one of the biggest hurdles to a real sea change.
Right.
You know, I mean, I think Patagonia, for example, is a great example of a company that lives this culture, and constrained growth is very natural for them. It's something that they live by. It's actually a point of strength for them.
And privately held is a different model than a publicly held model.
Exactly.
Right.
And so that, to me, that seems like a really big chasm. That way of thinking about the short term versus the long term, and how focused, you know, we are kind of in the financial world, especially in today's, you know, the next quarter's earnings statement is really you know, we're one heartbeat away from not being in business anymore for certain companies. And so, what do you think it takes? How do we do that differently?
Yeah. So. It's actually a great question, and I think on the private versus public conversation, that could be a whole other segment unto itself, although I've always felt like it's a challenge when public companies, the missive is to maximize shareholder return.
Right.
I think there's a whole other conversation and deep dive on just that and what that means. But here's how I hold it. So independent of anything green or sustainable, and I say this all the time, it's not about being a green brand or sustainable brand. It's about being a relevant brand. That's what great brands are.
Right.
They optimize resonance and relevance, right? So I think it would be hard to argue that doing the right thing right now, especially in terms of those you serve, those consumers.
It'd be hard to argue that it's irrelevant.
That it's irrelevant, right.
Right.
In fact, many purpose-driven brands during this period of economic Katrina have actually done well.
Absolutely.
I think from a board perspective, it shouldn't be it's green, it's sustainable. It's about a positioning, this is what makes us relevant. IBM is a good example, a public company, right? And their ability to switch the conversation to a place of strength because they understood the relevance of who they are, the global need, and to kind of find the nexus between those in a way that actually optimizes that is brilliant.
And then it resonates beyond shareholder value.
Yeah, because the other thing, it shows you can do the right thing and do well. Interface carpet, do the right thing and do well. It doesn't have to be this mutually exclusive dialogue, but it comes down to what is relevant.